so nice to see so many friends and fans of John Sager's. I'm Annette Carlozzi. I'm a curator here in town. I know most of you, so I won't do more introduction than that. This is the artist, John Sager, whose wonderful works you all stand. John and I are going to do a conversation about the work. We'll stay seated for as long as the conversation lasts, and then we'll probably get up and wander around just to look at some works in greater detail. I think the biggest challenge of today is to be heard, because we're not amplified, and both John and I tend to be soft speakers, although we can use our presenter voices, and we'll try to do so. If you can't hear at any point, will you do us the favor of just holding your hand up? And we'll know it's not a question, we'll know it's a, yeah, do the hand to the ear thing. And don't be embarrassed by that. John and I have known each other for many, many years. We first met because I went to work, moved back to Austin, and went to work at what was then called the Huntington Art Gallery at UT, later became the Blanton. And John was already a well-seasoned member of the installation crew there. Yeah, from 96, I got that.
I started in 1980.
Yeah, well-seasoned member of the installation crew there. And there are others in the room that I remember from those days and later. He always stood out to me, both as a maker with his own practice at home, which he alluded to every once in a while, but generally didn't talk about much. Although you'd always get an announcement from one of his many galleries about an upcoming show, and that was really exciting to see. And if I was traveling, I would stop and see those shows in Houston or wherever. Not the ones overseas, though. I wish I could have seen those. But he stood out as a member of the installation crew because of his, I'm just going to riff here, exquisite sensitivity to the works of art. This was the man we relied on always for all the years I was there to do the lighting, which is one of the most challenging tasks of presenting art in a public space. He could see the reflections, the shadows, the absorptions, the way color was amplified or muted. He was sensitive to those things. I couldn't even see that. I've always said, and unfortunately you've enabled me, I've always said, I can't do lights, John does the lights. You know, and even in our house, I can't see light on art very well because I was spoiled by John. The other thing that was unusual about you as an installation colleague was curators are designing displays of art. That's why I'm working so closely with the installers. It's a team that makes the whole thing happen. Was that you knew the collection so well. And I think not everybody who passed through for shorter stints on the installation crew took the time to get to know the collection beyond the things that were on view. And certainly in the old building, not a lot was ever on view over at the Ransom Center before we got the large space that you now know as the Blanton. You knew the things that were in storage. You helped me go down into storage, what I like to call double-double storage, which was like way in the basement of the HRC, and it took like four people to pull the racks that the paintings were sort of thrown away on. And there were some amazing things down there. It took me a good year of being there to get through all of it and get a sense of what was there. But it was always fun when planning installations because John, if I stopped for a minute in my slow way of looking and thinking, he would say, what about the Sam Francis? What about them? Because he knew there were works that would work in a grouping. And that was really fun to have another person who had that mental imagination of a catalog of works of art all the time. So that's just some of who John was in his working life or his day job, you show up to the plant.
Yeah.
But it's as a maker, of course, that most of you have come to know the work, and it's through the making that we get to sit in the midst of all this wonderful art today. I thought in asking questions, I would start with kind of the physical material nature of the work, and then we would move to the realm of ideas around the work, the philosophy of the work, because I know John thinks deeply about all those things. It may swerve off course, we'll kind of follow it where it goes. But that might be a place to start. And because that's such a concrete place to start, I would welcome questions, not like that, but like that, from the audience, because everybody always wants to know how things are made. And so if we don't cover something and you're just dying to know, that's a great time to ask a question. Does that sound like a plan?
Yes, it does.
Okay, it's a plan. We're agreed.
Cool.
Okay, so. Do you just keep bins and piles of stuff that you draw from? Do you pull one out and start to build a work around it? Do you go searching in the bins for the thing you're looking for? Or do they talk to you from wherever they're located?
Every possible direction and way. We've got stuff underneath our bed, got stuff everywhere, basically. We can still get both cars in the garage, but there's mobiles hanging between the two cars. So you have to walk sideways and hunch back to try and get around everything. And the garage is a good place for collections of all kind. Our closets are totally full. You can barely get in.
And this is with the raw material of art.
Yeah. Which is found objects, basically.
Yeah.
I don't know. Where do you shop?
Well, when I used to shop, it'd be places like the Austin Antique Mall, which is just off Burnett 183. That's a great place to shop.
I know. I mean, where do you get in this?
Oh. Another place is Uncommon Objects.
Always.
Yes.
South Austin now. Whose director is a great artist himself.
Steve Wyman.
Assemblage, he does assemblage hangings, very, very nice ones. Any place and every place. People send me stuff. I've been in a couple dumpsters, but I don't do that anymore.
Have you always been a collector? Were you the little guy that was always picking up stuff? Yes, you were. You talk about being in your grandfather's place.
Yeah.
Growing up doing that. Tell us more about that.
When I was a kid, my grandfather was a Chevy mechanic in Farrell, Texas, which is 5 miles outside of Taylor, Texas. But they had a pretty big Chevrolet shop, and so I'd spend weeks with them, and so we'd get up at 8 in the morning, ride half a mile in the pickup to Highway 79 and go to work. And so I would spend pretty much the whole day in the junkyard behind the building playing with stuff. You know, I'd just start playing with stuff. At 10 o'clock and at 3 o'clock, I'd get a nickel, so I'd go to the canning machine and the soft drink machine. And back then, everything was a nickel.
Nickel went a long way.
And then at lunch we'd come back, drive back home, eat, take a nap, and then go back from 1 to 5. So we'd spend the whole day playing with objects and flywheels and anything that was in a car, basically. So that's when I...
Was it important that you get to make something lasting from it, or could you just build stuff and let it go, or knock it down and start over?
Yeah, at the end of the day, I'd just knock it down and go to a different part of the junkyard. It was a pretty big junkyard.
Yeah.
And then, as a 9-year-old, my dad loved to go to World Fairs, so we went to the Seattle World's Fair in 63, so I was 9 years old. And we got there, and my eyes just got big, because every country had just a beautiful building. And they'd have art in the building and activities going on, so it was a big deal for me anyway. And then 64, 65, we went to New York City. 67, we went to Montreal, so as a kid. And we couldn't afford hotels, so we'd camp at the edge of the city and drive in every day. So that was interesting as well.
Who was the first person that you knew to be an artist?
Well, in high school, in Sioux Falls, South Dakota, I went to the downtown old high school. My mom was a guidance counselor at the new high school on the edge of town. And she hooked me up with their shop teacher who did wood and metal. So I spent three or four lessons with them learning how to weld. Mm-hmm. So I did my first piece of welding with the shop teacher at the high school. And he was an artist as well. He was downed object. So that was really the first artist I knew when I was 18.
Did you have any sense that it was the kind of thing you could do for your lifetime, that you could do for a living? Let me correct that. Of course you could do it for your lifetime, but yeah. You could do for a living.
But yeah, well, still, I don't do it for a living.
Y'all get busy out there.
But, let's see.
It's just a way of life.
Yeah. My first 2 years in college, I thought I wanted to become an architect, but then I met with Ralph Rapson, who did the Guthrie Theater in Minneapolis, I think. And he said, well, son, the first 8 years you're going to be drawing doors and windows for somebody else. That did not appeal to me. So I became an artist. But big interest in architecture.
Yeah, and that's, we can feel that all around us. We'll come back to that, looking at some individual works.
Question. You call it steampunk. I mean, is that part of, is this kind of like steampunk, or is it steampunk, or is it just something different?
I've heard the term.
One of my friends was saying, oh, that looks like steampunk. And I was like, so I looked that up, but I mean, kind of. But
yeah, that's a new term. I've heard the term, but from what I've heard and seen, a lot of that's moves, maybe.
And it, well, I don't know. Or, industrial parks and things like that.
But this is just the old school, I call it.
I think steampunk, you could understand it as a very specific, almost niche kind of description of works that draw from the industrial environment. And there are probably just as many other little niche words that I don't know that describe other versions of it. But you're absolutely right that this is found objects drawn from industrial detritus or waste or things people have thrown away or domestic things. But then there's also, talk a little bit about the natural forms that are present in what you do, the little fossils and...
Oh yeah, as a kid I had rock collection, shell collection. I put together models of cars and battleships. Even did the Space Needle. They had a little model of the Space Needle in Seattle, so I bought that and put it all together. And had a train set, so I'd build the city around the train set, which involves a little bit of architecture.
Yeah.
Put together little houses, plastic houses. I'm not sure.
One of the things I love knowing about your work, and you write about it beautifully in your artist statement and have written about it in other ways as well, are the ways in which you stay really open to not just the potential of material to become art, not just architecture and the forms that have influenced you, but music and literature and poetry in particular. And you and Johnny both have built a life that is about sharing this, I'll use the word exquisite again, appreciation for cultural activities. And it's like the sphere that you live within, you know, it's just completely infused every aspect of your life. Can you talk about that a little bit? Because it's not true for every artist. I mean, a lot of artists like play music in the studio, and you could talk with them about music's influence. But I think poetry and architecture and literature are so present in all your works.
Yeah, music is a big deal. In school, grade school and high school, I was in the band, the orchestra. High school played in a rock band. First year of college in Minneapolis, I played in four different groups and kind of let my studies go. did not make straight A's. But played in a group called Cabaret, which went around to nightclubs, and they had four singers and four musicians and played the music of the 60s and played in the orchestra.
What instruments did you play?
Timpani and percussion. Percussion bass. Cool. And played in an old-timey jazz band that the professors had going. So once a month, the professors at the college, Oxford College, got together and played old-timey jazz, so I became the drummer for that. Which meant moving the drums, which is, I've had to move stuff my whole life. But music, musical instruments have such a beauty in their shape, you know, and they've been designed and been around for, I don't know, 500 years? Some things, pianos and saxophones and trumpets, trombones. So I like to use the bow for a violin. It's just a beautiful arc, you know, has a beautiful arc. And I often use the mouthpieces for trumpets and trombones. Of course, piano keys, and even from a music machine or a music piano, that's the inside, and it plays a tune as I go around. And the piano board from the bottom of a piano. So, yeah, I just find musical instruments are just automatic beauty for me. You know. So I use them whenever I can.
A question. In terms of art history, do you look at like the surrealists and people do assemblage, pronounce it right, like Joseph Carnell and others? Have they influenced you at all on any specific artists?
Joseph Carnell was, when I saw his work, I said, well, box art, that's the best that can be. Well, you know, there's no way I could do box art, but I met a guy by the name of Joseph Doherty, and he did box art, but it was a different direction. It was just as beautiful, you know, as Joseph, and so he said, come and make some stuff. So I went to his house and started box art. So I went through a box art for about 10 years of box making. But then I got out of the box and
talking about finding use in materials. You were telling me the other day that this piece, which you can all see, sit on these beautiful yellow pine boards.
Oh, yeah.
Tell where you got them from.
Well, the HRC on UT campus, Humanities Research Center, one day they decided that the yellow pine boards might be off-gassing. It might be affecting the paper in the building. So these went out the door onto the loading dock, and they brought in steel shelving, you know, which is safer for paper objects. And so all the artists in town came and picked up the three-quarter inch thick, 7-inch wide pine boards. And I started, you know, they have such a beautiful grain to them, I started using them as a base. This is called Moon Over Gotham. So it's a cityscape, which kind of ties in with wanting to be an architect. And then just a simple moon coming up over the city.
Tell the story, if you will, when you and Johnny were traveling a couple of years ago and you went to France to see Corbusier's church. Can you talk a little bit about the goal to do that and the experience of being there? This is imagining architecture as he talks.
Well, my dad was a Lutheran preacher, as was his father and my grandfather. So I was brought up in the Lutheran church, but I started to get an eye for different churches and cathedrals. And my favorite cathedral is the one at Ronchamp by Le Corbusier, which is, I can't even explain it to you. It's kind of like an overturned boat, but for me, it just looks beautiful.
It's all swoops and curves.
Yeah, different size cubic windows, different size windows. And but we're going to London, and I decided, well, this might be my last chance. And so we hopped on the train, and in 3 hours, we were over in France. And Ronchamp does not have a train station, and so the little commuter train stopped, dropped us off, Then we had to drag our suitcase up over the steel bridge that went across the track. And there's only maybe 1,000 people living in Ronchamp. But then up on the hill, we could see the big white cathedral. And it was a pretty neat deal. I've wanted to see it my whole life, but it was built in 1955, I think. About my same age.
Yeah.
But it was a pretty grand event for me.
Did you get to go inside?
Oh, yeah, I went inside.
Yeah.
And spent a lot of time photographing, but I finally had to set my camera down and just enjoy the church. And it had three little pocket chapels in it, which added to it. And the different colored glass, and it was still a working cathedral. It had nuns coming in, and we were supposed to be quiet and not take pictures. You know. But and it's still open to the public.
It's one of the landmarks of 20th century cultural creation. Has anybody else been there?
No.
Been here? Yeah. I've always wanted to go.
Highly recommend.
I was so envious when you told me about it.
So
you wanted to be an architect, and that's informing partially your sensitivity to an imagination of kind of architectural forms, making architectural forms out of other things. What about literature and poetry, which of course all of us have available to us, but you've done a deep dive into how? What's the deep dive like?
Well, yeah, Joseph Doherty, again at UT, I came in and he was just writing a little book, and I couldn't figure it out. But then he started to share his poems with me, and I said, man, those are pretty good. And he was also the box maker, and so he invited me over to make boxes, and so I started making boxes and writing some poems. But I really only had two kind of major poem times. One was back in the 90s when I met Joe, and then during COVID, for some reason I couldn't focus on art, and so I spent 2 years and maybe came up with 20 poems. And so that was a different way of being creative. But then now I got back to making art, so it might be another 20 years before I write another poem.
That'd be too bad, because they're really beautiful. That's another question.
Could you describe your box art? I'm curious about that.
Oh, just...
Is it wood boxes?
Or yeah, kind of like those two kitchen drawers on the wall over there.
Oh, okay.
There's two wooden kitchen drawers that came from
older
houses, and just decide what to do with it, you know. And I kind of divided them up. Kind of like Mondrian, where some squares are big and some are rectangles and some are small.
Mm-hmm. And put things in them.
Because Mondrian was a big influence on me.
That's sort of box art, right? Behind you.
Isn't that's it? Right. Yeah, that's a box. That's a box as well.
Okay. You start seeing them everywhere. Most things are boxes. Yeah.
Then a clock is kind of a box, and then it holds the workings of a clock. But I like the negative space of wood.
Question. I want to ask about your book art.
Yeah.
What inspires you on your book art, and what books do you choose based on the title or the thickness of the book, or how do you get your ideas for how you start? Like there's a piece behind you.
Oh, yes. Yeah, I'm not sure how I got into book art. But I started collecting books that had the word city in them, which relates back to architecture, I guess. But that's called The Voice of the City. And so I made a staircase for this little figure, so he'll go up the staircase and crawl up into the word bubble from a newspaper or magazine. And so he's up there, he got up there, and he's staring out at us. And Voice of the City was written by O. Henry, who also happened to live in Austin for a while. But yeah, it's almost another type of architecture, the book. There's other books around.
You can see the one right there. Some people can see in the middle.
Yeah.
Tell us about that one.
Well, that book has, every summer we went to Oregon and watched the fireworks over the ocean. And so the next day we go back to the beach and there's the remnants of the fireworks, like bottle rockets or something, and also driftwood. And so I put the bottle rocket detritus up on top and the driftwood on the bottom. And that was an album, photographic album from way back when, where you put your maybe your wedding picture on the left side, and then you'd stack your pictures.
Only Johnny can do that.
You'd stack your pictures. So that became kind of, it's another type of box art, pretty much, but with a book.
So you often use the titles of the books as titles for the works of art, right? And sometimes you can see the title, it's really evident, and other times you can't. Like the three works that are on the flip side of the wall, we all have some memory of them coming in. Oh, wow, look at those.
Yeah.
And you're using the bindings of the books.
Yeah.
Obviously, yeah?
Yeah. Tearing the cover off. And these are all books that people either throw away or you get them for a dollar at half price books. But the binding, you take the cover off of the binding, you know, it's 50 years old maybe, but it has a different sewing pattern on it, you know, to sew the binding together. And the different colors of the paper. And so I just started using those and cut on the bandsaw and just started. I used the same board and cut the pattern, what I wanted, and then started gluing books to each side and on the ends to kind of form a forming process.
I'm interested in how you see, like, if you see objects, right? Do you say, oh my God, that's a great piece of artwork, or, and I have just the purpose for it right now, or do you say, well, just it's a neat shape and maybe someday I'll find a place for it?
Both directions, yeah.
Which do you think it's more often, is it like, oh my God, it's like, this is...
Yeah, the neat shape attracts me first.
This is gorgeous, right?
So I keep that in the garage for years until I decide what to do with it. And kind of a rising sun, but it's also a figure. It's like this figure or the figure on the other side of this wall for me. And the negative space is just as important for me in the center. But of course it's from a piano again, so you know, to me that part of the piano is beautiful, like the keys are, the white keys.
You talk about negative space. Do you feel like things, the framing of boxes or whatever, constrains it, or do you think it sort of embraces it and kind of holds it in there like caressing it or something?
Exactly, both ways.
Good words.
Wise guy.
Yeah, it does frame the other objects, and but then the negative space is, you know, it's just as beautiful.
Are you thinking philosophically while you're making work, or this is just part of your creative process? It's all just part of you when it comes out.
Well, I think first of all, it's my eye enjoying the shape, basically the shape of each object that I work with, the shape, and then assembling them in some form. I wish I could bring in some great philosophical concept.
Well, related to that, question, and then related to that, I'm also getting kind of a spiritual charge off of the things that you do. I'm calling it philosophy, but it's also just about this kind of more elevated, more utopian idea of what the world could be, what we can make happen. It's positive in that sense. There's a real kind of faith, not religious faith necessarily, but faith in the works as I see them. Is that, do you think of this as like a spiritual practice, making your works, or is that too highfalutin for you?
Well,
building a kingdom?
That's a nice phrase.
Yeah, I work pretty quiet at home, so it could be, I'm not sure if it's spiritual or just.
Every object has kind of something to say.
Yeah, every object has a home or a meaning or worth. That's
value.
Worth.
Value. Yeah.
It's history.
History doesn't have to be monetary values.
Right.
You know, with your eye or your heart.
The question I have, John, is actually two questions. One is, what are the themes of your life, i.e., what are the values that you hold most dear, and do you think they are reflected in your art?
Sorry, that's a very better way of saying what I tried to say.
Well,
because I do see some themes in this book.
Let's hear what you see.
I see the value of all things.
Yeah.
I see it's not just valuing something like these pieces, but it's saying that there's something beautiful about them, yeah, and that they're more than utilitarian. They enhance our lives by what they do. They add to our lives, i.e. they give us pleasure, they allow us to express ourselves through our work, many things. I love this piece. My husband said, if you could buy a piece in the show, which one would you buy? And I said, it's this one. And I think it's absolutely beautiful because it can mean many things to many people, but I see it as like a sunflower. I see it as something that is just saying, here I am, world, I'm beautiful, come and look at me. I love the colors in it, I love the composition. So, you know, I think that when he created this, he may not have been thinking, what are my values, what are my grand things? But I think to be able to create this expresses all of that joy of life and of being.
Yeah.
And I really appreciate this piece.
I would like to ask this woman here if you ever thought about being a coach for writing artist statements.
No pressure, but would anybody else like to make a comment? Because truly, I think one of the greatest gifts you can give an artist is to put words to what they've done, because what we're seeing testament to here is that as complex as John's thinking is and making process is, it's not really about the words. He'll sit down and write gorgeous words about the world, not so much about the work. And so, you know, even I'm trying to be conscious to kind of throw words in his direction just because I know Johnny's listening. words matter, and it's a challenge to try to figure out how to talk about art. That's my lifelong challenge. And if anybody else would like to just throw out, not poetic necessarily, but just, you know, it makes me think of this, or it makes me feel this way, or I wondered that when I saw that work, it would be welcome, I think. Can I speak for you?
Oh, yes.
Yeah. So, huge pressure now. Go ahead, sure.
I'm not sure I'm responding to what you just invited.
Go around. Take it and run.
And it's on a lower plane in your comments, for instance. But this is what the question is going to be about. One thing that I attach it to is what you said about your ability to light and what you're seeing, and how to light that. And I'm wondering, because so many of your pieces are, I guess everything you say is three-dimensional, but especially the ones I can see here, is do you ever think about the shadows that will be created? Yeah.
Yeah, I think my most favorite thing at the museum was lighting, because you deal with paper, which can't be too bright, and you deal with paintings, which might reflect depending on the surface. And of course, sculpture was my favorite thing to light, but you only have so many cans, so some sculpture would get one can. Bigger sculpture might get three if you're lucky, but then you decide, where do you want the shadows to be? Or what do you want to highlight? Which side do you want to highlight? So I get to pick that, and just try and do the best I can.
And also, I guess, if you change your mind and move it in terms of the focus, you're
That's
going
right.
to have something different.
Yeah.
And one of the geniuses I worked with John way back in the day is that we didn't have dimmers, we didn't have diffusers, we had lenses that would either make it a spot or make it spread better, but we used aluminum screen cut into circles. And you would build those up, the amount you used to get the the light reading for the painting or the paperwork, which was genius.
I enjoy it.
Here, I'd like to comment on the book art and how I've always loved the humor that John brings to using the titles of the books and making the art kind of work humorously with that as well. And then it goes right through a lot of the art.
Great point. It's not self-important. It has a sense of humor about itself.
Yeah. Question, have you ever met the people who created these things, these objects you found, and they have seen it, you've repurposed it, and have you ever thought, oh my God, I never thought that my clock face would become a sculpture, or a piece of my piano scroll would become a sculpture?
They might all be dead.
What's this going to be on?
Now we're going to look at this piece again.
They're a lot of old things.
Yeah, I haven't met the original owners of it. Mainly everything.
My grandmother.
Oh, yeah.
The big piano piece
was from Johnny's grandmother. And they couldn't tune it anymore out in Oregon, where it was. And so her brother took it apart and put it in a box and shipped it to her. And so it sat in the garage for maybe 5 years, and then finally had the idea to make a person or a figure out of it. So I pulled the cars out, trying to figure out what the thing's going to be. And I basically put it together at the museum in the lunch room. We're all in the basement. Of course, the shop is always in the basement. But during lunch, I would figure out what I need to drill and drill a hole through every single piano key, you know, to get it to work. And then figure out what you need for a bass. So steel, went to the steel company and got basses done, and then got them welded and drilled and figured out, and then you got to move it. So I made it where it comes apart, but even then it's pretty heavy.
I have a question. John, do you sketch out ideas before you begin, or is it all happening as the process just happens?
A lot of sculptors are able to do a sketch, but I never had the inkling to sketch. You know, when I get an idea, I might do a rough sketch so I can remember which parts kind of go where. But it's not a beautiful sketch like a lot of sculptors can do.
Except for the tower. You sketched out what you wanted each thing in the blood boxes. You had that totally sketched out, each piece. Glued them together and put it in the sections, but you knew exactly how you wanted the pattern to end up being.
And it's one thing to be the artist and make all this stuff, but then the gallery also does a good job of picking wall colors and doing lighting and doing all the public relations. So I say thank you to everybody at the gallery here and to the public, because when I'm not making art, I'm the public as well. I go to art museums and galleries, and I'm enjoying the art also.
I think it's fair to say that from now on, when anybody sees any interesting anything, they'll be thinking, John maybe could do something. So the gallery may have to field the inquiries on that.
I'm first going to ask if you accept donations, things that, like, I'm putting Goodwill boxes to take to Goodwill. Now I think, would John like to add to everything?
Take a little phone picture of it first.
Yeah, if it's small and interesting, I might be interested.
Tell me, John, about your collages, and is that a particular time in your life, or you do that sporadically?
So the squares came from, in In high school, I was taking mechanical drawing, and you get those 8x10 sheets of paper where you'd have to draw a piece of machinery or something. And so they were kind of divided up into quarter-inch squares. So I think I got the idea of doing collages right on those pieces of paper I had left over, which was hundreds of pieces. And so I started doing my first collages on those mechanical drawing 8x10 pages. So they were kind of like a graph paper. And so I got into the quarter and half inch squares. And so that kept my attention.
Interesting that you used National Geographic, and I forgot the other.
Oh, Christie's Art Catalogs.
Okay.
So I had a bunch of both of those, and so you could get skies and people from them, and hands, and get hands. And looking at her hands now, they look pretty similar, but in the catalogs and in artwork, they're very, very dissimilar. And artists using hands is pretty interesting.
Is that what drew you to them? Is because they're so different?
Hands, yeah.
And based on what John's been talking about, you have a new way to walk around and see the exhibition right now. I mean, I want to go look at the other collages now with a fresh eye. I want to make sure people don't miss the pieces behind the wall here, because they're total knockouts.
There's four pieces in the next room.
Yeah, there's some in the next room and this side of the wall. Yeah. Final call for questions from people.
I think these pieces right over here talk about the shadow, when you talk about shadows and the lighting, how important. This is one of my favorite pieces that you've done.
Yeah.
And the shadow is the most important part, I think.
Shadow.
So it's quite interesting, the lighting, how important that plays a role.
Yeah, to have a light on each artwork is a great deal. Mm-hmm. Because at the house, you know, it's not that way.
For me, like, I really enjoy seeing all this amount of all these things, and you know, the work I do, I also use a lot of those. But my favorite of your work are those that are strong on the negative space. This little one with the little architecture, little stairs, I love that. I think that's so poetic and delicate, and the negative space is so strong.
That's true.
And as well as the two, the lotus and the two towers against the wall also, like, really seduce me. It's interesting because we see it even more because there is such an accumulation of you know, such a quantity of other stimulating, interesting shapes, and suddenly the negative space takes like a different dimension.
That's right.
Right.
So
that's right.
Well, the show is the whole thing. That is the note I think we can end on. It's just the wonder and the beauty of everything that's here. Take a moment and look at the spaces that were hidden by our friends in the room and see what's behind them. Before you leave, take a last look. I think it doesn't matter how many times you come, you'll find something different to look at, and that's the gift of how an artist like John works, is that very astute question. I want to know how you see, and then you also find out how we ourselves see in the process. And this is important to hold on to. So.
John, are these finished for you, that you don't go back and say, oh, I need to add one more place?
They're finished. <Yes. laughs> Except for moving them back and forth.
Yeah.
That never ends.
Yeah.
Cool. Thank you all for coming.